So, this is the last day. In principle, course is over because you have already taken the exam also, right? But then, there are a few take-homes from the whole course. First and foremost is, yes, the power networks are getting changed. We are getting into the domain of microgrids, nanogrids, hybrid mode of operation, and dispersed generation. But still, there is a need to operate grids, have giant grids, and that's where IoT engineering plays a large role. And we have had some of the new issues which are coming up as a result of using renewable energy is impact of power electronic converters coming into the picture, and the development of DC circuit breakers based on the power electronic devices. All this will lead to different kind of stresses on the insulation, which were not seen till recent times. See, earlier we were only thinking of, say, AC stress, DC stress, and then the impulse, maybe switching, lighting. And then when we came to 800 kV AC, we thought about pollution. But now, with the new thing, we're going to get repetitive discharges and much shorter pulse times of the order of 300 nanoseconds. And all said and done, with all these things, like, you know, if you ask a power transmission expert, he says, corona is not good during the steady operation, but is useful during a transient, to die down the transient. So the same way, some of these transients are usefully employed, and that is the purpose of this talk today. In fact, when we visited the electrospinning lab yesterday, they were only talking everything oriented towards healthcare applications. Okay, but the bottom line there was charging, depositing, extending, maybe drawing the fiber. If you can draw a fiber, you can draw a cloth. That's the basic thing. That's how I look at it. Now it's creation, creativity in you can decide where it can be applied. We are only going to show you few applications. And there's one very important thing in understanding the whole thing is being able to create stress, control stress. That means the entire high voltage engineering relies on electrostatics. And that's, so we'll also try to have a small idea about electrostatics and how you should go about computing. So now I hand over to Professor Jairam. She will talk about electrostatic precipitators. In fact, this is where the very first application where you saw this aerosol being formed, aerosol being charged, aerosol being carried. There is a small difference. We'll see what the difference is.
Okay, thank you, Professor. So today we are staying out of power engineering business. We'll see the other side of high voltage engineering applications. We are also going to switch the talk so that you don't get bored of my voice for the rest of the day. Professor Kishore will give a talk on electric field and stress computational part after this, and then we come back and talk about the other two applications. And I think this is just to show that how many types we can see in a very massive scale already the applications are used. Yesterday and day before yesterday in lab you saw the experiment how a droplet can be formed into an aerosol material. And yesterday also we understood that 2.3 mainly liter of that solution she was making into such a big mass structure. So that's the whole idea here is to used electrostatic principle for pesticide spraying, which I'm not covering later, that's why I thought that. So we all know that we live in a world today, you can't buy something that doesn't have a pesticide sprayed unless you want to go for organic food. And there is also concern, okay, if this field is where the organic farmer is having, people are spraying that side, people are spraying this side, what guarantee, nothing reaches. So then lots of those questions. And the So they try to minimize the pesticide use, but effectively maximize its effect. So that helps with the electrostatic precipitator. The very, very thin layer they can get. The droplets will be so small. And far away they can spray. So technique is efficient. And more than anything, the amount of pesticide they have to use for covering 1 acre land, as opposed to doing it by hand, it's substantially low. And that's what we want, because we don't want to eventually eat the same food which has pesticide sprayed. And the crop also, we don't want to lose the crop too. This is another application I won't be covering, that's electrostatic spray painting. And today, as we all know, that no automobile industry is going to do any other technique other than using the electrostatic spray painting. And there are more challenges for them, how to deposit these particles of powder paint very uniformly, as thin as possible. Once again, everywhere the economy comes, okay, can I get it done at a maximum efficiency of spraying with minimum amount of usage? At the same time, I think there's a push from the environment also that water-based paints are more preferred than the other chemicals. And again, getting that finish final, like most people finish, like the car to be having a metallic finish. So getting those finish is possible, controlling many parameters. We'll talk about the spray, this electrostatic precipitator. I don't want to get into these fundamental physics where very high, extremely high electric fields are used to look inside even the atoms or molecules, or even to cause the breakdown of those. So these are the three areas we are covering: emission control using electrostatic precipitator, and either spraying or electrospinning. We'll cover a bit of that later. And biotechnology applied to food processing or cell biology. Seen near any thermal power stations, how much emission we are getting here. I think depending on, again, the policy from the government, there are very stringent rules how much of particulate contamination can be emitted. The way the measure of these particulate contamination has also changed over the decades, because we have a better instrumentation to measure now. Earlier we thought, okay, we can't allow more than 0.5 milliamps in the ground current because we couldn't measure 0.05 milliamps. But now we know we can measure even femtoampere. So then we say, oh no, even nanoamperes is too much. So that's a relative term again. The role of electrostatic precipitation in emission control. And most of the slides, there are contents, I'll skip them. So this is just to show that where the problem is. Obviously, our automobiles are also a big source of pollution. And a lot of large industries, in particular cement industries and paper mills, effluents, and then fossil fuel, a lot of them. When we think about the contamination, there are two types of contamination the precipitators can help: solid particles for filtering purpose, and another one is oxides of nitrogen and sulfur. I mean, the buzzword is not as subsided now. 10 years ago, everybody talked about acid rain. I don't know, maybe diversion is away now. We don't talk too much. So when you have oxides of nitrogen or oxygen emitted through those gas chimneys, then if there is a chance of having rain or a moisture thing, then high chances of forming nitric acid and sulfuric acid. And if it is raining, if that water mixes with our natural water, even ground water or anything, or the lakes, then we are concerned about the living organisms. And if they don't live in that level, we'll have trouble at the bigger animals will have trouble. We have to have those microflora or whatever they talk about. Okay, then this slide will skip, just a comparison about the size of particles. Again, I'll skip many of them. Just to pay attention here, certain industry effluents, the particle size is higher than micrometer. In some industries, petrochemical is another industry too. Petrochemical, those industries, the particles are much smaller. The concern also if the particle becomes fine, then it's hard to filter. At the same time, you can inhale them. That's why it's not in the part of this slide section. After we started working in nanomaterial, maybe applicable for you also. There are no guidelines set yet. Everybody started using nanoparticles. Just to share one of the experiences with our university, they are becoming too rigid on the safety guidelines. Every month we had to do the safety guideline. They wouldn't let our lab use even our particles. The ones we are using is oxide of silica or like SiO2 or titanium oxide TiO2. They said, no, the particle size you are using is not acceptable. We had to bring a chemist into the lab and be sure they are non-toxic. No, it's not the toxicity of the material. In fact, to get nice texture for the ice cream, they use TiO2. To get that white color in milk, they use TiO2. Right? So what they are telling, so the magnitude of TiO2 you can consume is not the question they are concerned about. The amount of TiO2 you can inhale is a big concern. So if it goes into your stomach, it's not at all. You may not even know. I didn't even know until last year when you buy milk, it looks white and nice. Probably if any of you have still relationships with your villages, when you see the milk, it is a bit more brown in the color, but when you buy from dairy, and it's very nice and appealing. The ice creams also, and you want very fluffy ice cream. That's what they play with to get. So, and we eat that, and nothing happens. But when you start inhaling, lung will get affected, and liver will get affected. That's why their concerns are more, so especially nanomaterial. And the electrospinning setup, FISA, is a very good that they are a medical screen. They have followed all the instructions and the guidelines. It's fully enclosed. So if you start spinning the fiber, you without you knowing, you'll be thinking, oh, what's this? It's on your body, too. Those fibers are very, you won't able to see them, where all they go. Okay? Maybe there's a ground somewhere else, the fiber gets fit. And they go into the atmosphere. So inhalation level, that causes more. This is why the concern with the oil industry, petrochemical industries or rubber industries, the fume has bad chemicals. If you inhale them, that's what they cause. So then now you have to make sure that we have a fume hood where all the mixing is done inside a fume hood. But they made sure that the exhaust from the fume hood should be at least minimum 3 floors higher. Because if you let it here, probably we may not be really protecting. So there are no strict guidelines yet, but they are trying to educate us because we are not chemists. We don't think this is wrong, this is right. We just do it. We got the samples. And later you don't want to hear bad things about your own health. Oh, I was exposed for this, exposed for that. So just be aware that handling powder form, it's really bad. It's bad being an Indian Hindu that I'm doing this, but after knowing, I thought I will do it. Because one of the experiments with the electrostatic precipitator we did with another university, we needed to create nanoparticles. Like it's fine. So what do? We bought, they call incense, we call agarbati. So we just bought them and we lit them, and it produces a lot of soot. And that's what we were using as a production of nanomaterial. After seeing that, I said, at least in India, we open this door, we open this door, we open the front door, there's air coming in and out. In the enclosed area where we live, because of the cold weather, everything is concealed. Then we light all this, and without your knowledge, I don't know how much of the nanoparticle I'm really exposed to. I stopped almost using, I don't know if it's good or bad, I just thought about that. And also I thought about when my son was born, he was born in Bangalore, first thing they were doing is right after the bath, they said, no, the baby will get cold. And they put that coal, like the burning hot coals, and they put all that nice smell, that helps to keep the bugs away, definitely helps to keep the mosquitoes away. And I was thinking, poor this kid, cannot even breathe himself, one day or 5 days old. Now we are putting this environment, it thicks content of in the air, if you look at that, they need to get good oxygen. So some of these, maybe we have to adopt, because knowing that from the chemistry side, how strongly it can affect. I didn't want to tell him, maybe he will complain me that, yeah, you're the cause, that's why I don't have this, that's why I don't have. Okay. Anyway, they were telling, these are the things we have to worry. But if you really want to do it, make sure you have the clean airflow, so at least you don't have the concentrated. That's exactly same as newspaper will complain. Oh, today downtown Kolkata has too much smog. It's hard to breathe. Oxygen level is low. But at home, we are creating that on our own without knowing. So just a small thing to share. It's nothing to do with religious. I'm not saying don't do it. You can always do it. Okay. Maybe somebody can take a statistical thing. What about our priest who have to expose every time? Can maybe do some analysis about their health condition. You may find a very good statistical model even to show that also. Okay. There are lots of variety of particles. In terms of the technology use, I was just sharing with them about using agarbatti, you know. We use that as generating the nanoparticles. So since then we did all those experiments, I stopped using agarbatti at home in our apartment. Like, it's all closed room, so I don't want to end up having all the fumes being inhaled back. I was just telling them, unlike in India, we get fresh air, open all the windows and everything. Right? Especially if you're sitting in an enclosed air conditioning room where the external air is not flowing easily, you better make sure that you get fresh air once in a while. Coming to this control techniques, there are a few options to control. So I'll really go through these very fast. Inertial control, low energy scrubbers, high energy scrubbers, fabric filters, and electrostatic precipitator. Our focus only here. We do have all the slides, so I think I made sure last night all the slides are ready. You are getting them by email, I think, no?
All the slides have been sent to all the participants by email, excepting my volunteers, whom I will give it later. The three of them, Mr. Nandi, Manjo,
and Anna. I have sent them.
You have sent them. To date, I have sent to all participants. Maybe you were writing the address, so you would not have seen the mail. Okay. Actually, I am handicapped for the last 2 days because in my building the internet is off.
Oh. And most of them, as you can see, are mechanical, like how the dynamics is used, the cyclone type, or the dirty gas is pushed from here. And liquid spray is done so that you, our idea is to capture the particles, not to let them out. Okay. And this fabric filters, they are the only problem with the fabric filter to get these particles to pass through, that depends on the size of the particulate contamination. If they are very fine particle, the pressure difference they have to think about, it's very thick material passing through, the pressure difference they have to think about is extremely high. So in order to get that difference in the pressure, they have to spend energy somewhere. So it's not, but it doesn't mean that they're not used, they're all used in combination. So that's the techniques there. And you can imagine the magnitude and the massive pollution we are creating here. So coming, so again, more sources of particulate contamination and the control methods used. Skip them too. So that's the device we are going to discuss a little bit more in detail. So this is an electrostatic precipitator. In simple design, so all it has is metallic plates here, and then a wire here. Okay. So if, yes. So this is the high voltage wire. You are applying a negative DC, and these plates are here. So that's where you want to generate. So we saw in lab connecting high voltage to a point electrode, you can create corona. So to maximize the efficiency of using the surface wire area or the volume, so long thin wires are used as opposed to point electrode. And the wire is kept at a negative DC, and the corona is created all along the wire. And as the ions are created, and how they move and cause help in capturing the gas which contains the particles. So you can, I'll show you as we go along. A large industry scale or a medium industry scale electrostatic precipitator looks like one of these. And you can't have only one plate, so there will be multiple electrodes, multiple plates. You can see the massive size of this also here. And this slide is good to pay few little attention. Particle size in micron, particles by mass in their size. So like larger the particles are up to 10 micrometer of course, and then anything below 1 micrometer is considered as fine, or below 0.1 micrometer into ultrafine. So all your nanoparticles are in that part. More often this is used, PM10 is used as a level of contamination control, where concentration was paid to 10 micrometer or less, and 2.5 means you are able to capture particles 2.5 or less, and PM1 is 1 micron or less, ultrafine is point. So this is a relative term they use for the measurements. So this gives you much more close up of a cross section of that particular precipitator we saw earlier. And you can see here, like everything has a two plates here, and in between there are wires. So these are the wires here. And they put some weight so that the wires are hung with straight line. Okay. So the field is much more uniform. And these are the collecting plates. Perpendicular to your geometry, the flow will be in the opposite, 90 degrees. And the term used for that gas coming off of your chimney, flue gas. So coming back to the physics of high voltage engineering, so these are the electrodes. There's a, and if you see a wire in a cross section, looks like a point electrode there. And definitely we have a highly divergent electric field. So you have a parallel plane electrodes here for both sides for the collector, and a thin wire in the center. Maybe you'll be covering electric field calculation later. So that's a highly divergent field or converging field lines. And we know exactly what happens in this case. So if the point electrode is kept at a negative potential, and most of the flue gas we are talking about, air is major component as well. And if there is ionization due to corona, then we generate both positive and negative ions. The electrode being at a negative potential, so you leave behind all the negative ions, positive ions are drawn to the ground. So what are the steps in operation of an ESP? Production of ions by corona, particle charging, and particle collection. There are three systems. So until yesterday, we talked about corona. We said we don't want corona. So power system engineers, they really don't want corona. We talk about like interferes with the communication line, interferes with the clearances we want. We may have to reduce the clearance. If there are solid insulators closer to where the corona is generated, degradation of the materials, and corona means a flow of current, so somebody has to pay, that means power losses in the system. But there are tons of positive side of corona being used, and one major application is in this precipitator. So we need to see how to produce corona, and we already know how to do that. So for practical perspective, we always try to do single wire was okay. But now how about they make the wire more like a barbed wire, or it has to be a sharp edge. The field, electric field has to exceed 3 kV per millimeter locally. How best you can do it, if you can get it applying only 10 kV, you are better. Or if you can have to go up to 30 kV, maybe you think, but you also think about how much the flow available for the gas to go. Okay. So multiple electrodes are used. And they also use multiple designs for your this central corona generating electrode. Okay. Instead of calling a wire, because they need not have to be wire, corona generating electrodes can be of different shape.
Yeah.
No, I got confused one time. There's one person from maybe from Europe. He kept getting cable for overhead transmission line.
Even in the Indian Army, I have seen, they say cable is going above the building. So
They use
wrong, because it's another conductor of the air insulation. Open. There is no sheath. Sheath is far off.
Yeah, overhead lines in some...
I find this problem with power system engineers too, especially working on system analysis without really looking at the physical system. They work only on
matter. Okay? What they do, any conductor is a transmission line for them. So, transmission line is a model, transmission line is the apparatus. They're two different things.
So one more definition before we start looking at more other details. What we are understanding here, we have to energize the electrostatic precipitator using high voltage DC. Okay, your goal is to generate a steady corona on this wire so that you have a constant source of ions that start moving towards the plate electrode. And you want to keep almost a steady condition of that. So if you are looking at 10 ion pairs per microsecond, that's what you want to keep generating. So that you have, the gas is coming at certain range of velocity. So to match the velocity of the gas coming in with the particulate contamination, the generation of ions has to be balanced. Right? Otherwise, the gas will escape without getting those charging particles done. So you need to energize the electrostatic precipitator. Energy of the whole thing comes from a high voltage DC source. You need a stable energy there. So that's what, and then it's not one electrode. Overall here, there are hundreds of those wire, center electrode wires. Every one of them has to be supplied. Okay. And it may look very easy here, wire with parallel, like a duct. But maybe you may cover that, I don't know. There's so much work is done to even calculate, using the numerical method or the finite element technique, how to calculate the ion generation here in this simple geometry, considering the flow which has a gas, the conductivity of the gas can vary depending on the contaminants level. So combining these three chemical properties of the air that comes in here, the flow rate and the non-uniform geometry here, still many people are doing calculating ionization, level of ionization and the magnitude of the charge and everything. And now you can imagine that you don't have one of them, you have multiple of those electrodes, and how to not to interfere from one electrode to another electrode without losing the efficiency. There will be interaction between the two. If you have more than one wire, now there will be some interaction between this presence of this wire and this second wire here. But we want to see location of those wires so that the field is still highest, giving you the large amount of charge carriers.
Here again, we would like to use as low a voltage as possible because from the point of view of safety, the voltage should be as low as possible. Low does not mean it is low. As low as possible to achieve the required field. This is very, very important.
So let's assume that because the symmetry exists, this is your wire, and what happens on this side also happens on this side. There is axis symmetry here. So this is the representation of the wire, and we are only looking to the one side of the wire. Okay, there is a symmetry on this side. The gas is coming here, and the wire means the electric field is in this direction. And by definition, if this is at a negative electrode, this is at a positive electrode, field is defined towards the negative point. So now what is happening, assume that there are more slides to show how the charging is done. Assume that there is lot of corona generated all along the wire, if we believe this is really true, very close to the wire. And then this is the region where the ionization happened, then they are moving. Now we are sending this dirty gas up here. So as the gas is moved, brought up here, the charges will start accumulating on the particle. It's called field charging. By field charging, the particle is now charged. So those particles, once they gain the charge, then between this plate electrode and the wire electrode, you have substantially high electric field as well, or the potential difference here. So that potential difference is going, or because of the distance, you also have the E field. So two things you want to make sure, that one of the reasons why negative corona is done. Inception of corona, when the wire or the this point electrode or the wire electrode or the divergent point is much lower. So for a given geometry, you can initiate corona at a lower potential. So that's what you want to do. But in that geometry, the breakdown will happen between the wire and the plate at a higher voltage than if it were to be positive. So that's what also is important. In order for these particulate contaminants, after they gain the charge from two different mechanisms, maybe by diffusion or by field charging, those particles have to be drifted to the plate electrode here. And that drift depends on the electric field. So you want to maximize that. So your geometry should be such that.
Five to 10 minutes.
Oh, finish this one? Okay, let's see. So these charged particles have to, when they're trying to travel in this direction, you know that they are carrying the charge, so they're already charged particle, obviously they'll like to go to the other electrode. Right? How fast you can push them depends how best electric field you can keep and keep the electric field going. Right? Now what happens eventually, this plate here collects all the dust. Charged dust will be collected. So here a bit more details about those conductors, dirty gas here, closer to the wire, how all the ionization region representing. Okay, so this little bit of this small area zoomed into this, further zoomed here. So every particle has many of those ions accumulated on the particle. So larger the particle you have, easier to capture them. Tiny particles are much harder. These are negative ions. We know the wires are at negative potential. These are neutral particles. Now they start attracting the negative ions. And another view here, charging and discharging. So there are two types of charging you can look at here, field charging and diffusion charging. Field charging is defined as, okay, every particle that enters into the high field region here has enough surface volume of the surface where all these ions can start depositing. First of all, to start with, if a particle enters the flue gas area, where you have ionic region, it is going to distract the field. So that you can see the distraction of the field. So eventually, when all the particle gains a lot of charge on itself, it reaches a stage where the field lines are diverting away from this, because this is fully negatively charged and these are negative ions, so they tend to go away. Okay? So this kind of helps us. So until it gets charged, the field line concentrates at the particle and brings all those ionic charges. When the particle is fully charged, because of the nature of the charge here, it starts repelling those ions. So overall, it helps in charging. That's what we want. This type of particle charging is called field charging. You need to have that substantial high electric field and also the corona there. Okay. Now this particle so heavily loaded with so much charge, it has a very big mass of charge. Field you have, it quickly goes down the line to the plate. Going like this. Okay. Once you fully charge them, that's very easy to get them. Larger the size, easier. Then it comes to diffusion charging, maybe challenge for you. You can do a lot of computational work in this area. So this work is being done. And it comes to diffusion charging, where we are talking about very tiny charges, and by random Brownian motion, the negative gas ions, they all start to divert away. You don't need a charge, unlike that a big charge like this. You have a negative charge, there's a positive electrode, it is drifted because of the electric field effect. But now in the diffusion part, no, they can randomly move. Okay? That helps with the particles which are fine particles for charging these fine particles. Once again, overall goal is to find those particles also charged so that we can try to remove them. Okay? So that's one of the scenes you can see, collecting electrode, how dirty it can get. Okay? And that's a scanning electron microscope with a 500 magnification, a clean surface like this, clean. After the collection, how dirty it can get. And we want that. The more it can collect, that's better for us, this electrode here. And so how far we can allow them to get collected? So how far we can keep going them to collect? So they all get collected, but some place you have to clean them. So that's where the rest of the, this is electrostatic precipitator is not just an electrical device, it's a big mechanical device. Mechanical engineering is all in, it should be there. What we call it as hoppers. Not sure these days whether they even go to flour mills. When we were young, we had to take wheat and get it, made it into flour or powder. They get it from Amazon.com.
Yes.
So then, he started vibrating it, okay, collect, and when you go home, mom will tell, did you make sure that fellow got all of our stuff? Yeah, mom, they, don't worry, no, you should ask them, otherwise, you understand what I mean? So we had to bang this material to remove the particles, and we can't sit and do what we can do in a flour mill. That's where they have lot of mechanical system. This is a rotating wrapper. So this is where extremely complex computational work I've seen. You have dirty gas, you have the flow, you have the nonlinearity. Now they have to predict what may be the magnitude already here collected. So because they want efficiency, you saw the big precipitator, so they want efficiency. How often you can vibrate? Yeah, I will do 100 times, and the bill will be a lot more for you for the electricity. They say, why, if I can get it 50 times, if I do the wrapping, I'm not going to spend energy to do 100 times. So all this has to be done in a real-time calculations, one to the other related. So that's how these wrappers, like hoppers, are working. Another thing here about the particle size, average size, and then percentage volume only. So if you have hypothetically, let's say 10 micrometer particle count is, let's say, only one, in that given volume, it takes up 27%. As opposed to if you have a particle of average size 0.25, you need those many particles to take 1% of the volume. Right? Or if you go by weight, it's even worse. You may think you had 10 grams of particulate contamination at the inlet. And the outlet, when you collect the gas, you may measure and you find that 0.05 gram is left behind. And the efficiency of the precipitators are defined based on collection and the input, whatever you are. We could reach easily up to 99.9%, but that was attached to what the particle size you collected. If I'm weighing, it's not definitely giving those these ultra-fine particles. So, but those are the concern for us now. So the efficiency of electrostatic precipitator 20 years ago was also 99.5. 10 years also 99.5. Today 99.5. But the demand for capturing the particle in the smaller and smaller size, now they define, no, we want to see how many particles. There are instruments available to even calculate after you collect what size of the particle, how many percent of them you captured, those are like that. Okay. Precipitator, you have to stop?
Sort of a wrap up.
Okay, there are single stage and multi-stage precipitators here, and sorry about all this. Okay, you can have only one stage, which means you have the plates here, you have the wires going in perpendicular direction, so you let the gas go, the wires are kept at certain high potential, ionization starts, particle charging starts, particle collection also is done at the same time. But in order to improve the charging and collection, that's the whole goal here, how to generate the ions, how to charge the particles, how to collect the particles. Two-stage precipitators are much better, efficiency-wise. So they do what they do here. Look at the electric field for drifting. It's much lower. Gap is too big. But as they finish charging, because that's where they want to keep the ionization very efficient, as the particles are charged here, they enhance the electric field here substantially so that you can collect them faster. The idea of maximizing ionization, maximizing the collection here. Then that shows again the two stages of electrostatic precipitator to improve the collection part. Then this first slide I used earlier, we have the negative ion source here. Ions are negative, so particles will get negatively charged. They move to the collector, which is going to collect all the particles they deposited on the plate. Okay. If you keep allowing the dust layer here to grow, again I told you, when they are going to shake the thing, collect the thing, or sometimes they even water washing is done to clean up the collected contaminants. They call scrubbers. They mix. Earlier I showed you there are scrubbers by only mechanical and then precipitator, but now mix the technology too. Use the precipitator to get them onto the collector and then they scrub them. And they use a lot of chemical oxo to get the particles stay inside. Retention is more important in the not letting them into the atmosphere. All automatic.
No, it's not a part of maintenance.
It's a part of the plant, so it has to continuously, depending on the calculations you make, it has to be done. Otherwise, the risk is the particle collected will re-enter the flue gas, and you will pollute the atmosphere. The second thing is what I want to tell you is really good plants. They go ahead one more stage. You have a furnace is there where the flue gas is going. At the entry to the furnace, you have the ESP, which collects all the and puts it in a hopper, which is washed, then sent for drying. Then you have valuable carbon in that. You want to recover that. You send it to a separator. You scrub it. Yes. So that is, in fact, the present day scenario is almost every power plant, they are trying to have a separator along with ESP so that don't lose. Coal is getting reducing. Amount of coal available on earth is depleting. See, we are fighting against that. Okay? Although we talk about so many other sources of energy, coal is the king still.
Yeah.
But most of all over the globe, the whole idea of looking at these coal.
Trying to get away from use
of coal. You are getting away from the use of coal, but you cannot fully avoid.
No.
That the thing is, you are postponing the end of life of coal, basically.
No, what is the percentage of electricity generated using thermal
energy? 50%. So I think you want to say something more? Otherwise, I just sum up some few things and then we close this.
Finish the topic here. So we already know. Oh yeah, this is a real time. That's where the system model is. What's the flow rate? Approximately concentration in the flue gas, and then ionization level, and they can measure the current through the rest of the air and everything, and that has to be automatically done. So what I'm trying to bring up here, this dark layer or the collected layer, is nothing but on a metallic plate, you have a lot of charge accumulating. So they go to the plate, because that's where the field comes to push. Whether they're fully neutralized or not is a question now. So that depends on, I'm not sure about that, I'm really sorry, I didn't learn all of it. I don't know the coal we are burning in India. So there are two types of coal within it. One type of coal, it produces the gas, so gas produced, which has all these parts of contamination. The coal itself has low resistivity. Another type of coal, we can't have a choice. Maybe in South America, the coal they get has a nature low resistivity. The coal we get in Canada has a nature high resistivity. That's the problem with your particles you're trying to collect. If they have high resistivity by nature, once you collect them here, you have a substantial electric field within this. So that electric field, this plan, at least everybody should learn before leaving the seminar, this workshop, that corona insertion is local, and 3.5 kilometers, millimeter is the one. So if you exceed the electric field here, upper range, which can reach that, then you have corona in the dust layer, which start doing that. So once you have dust and corona from the collecting plate, then you have what we call it as a
back corona
here. Okay. So now this was a negative wire. if there is ionization here, you collected the positive charges away, only you get the negative ions here. Now you are creating corona, the positive plate here, and then ionization here. That means negative charges are all gone, positive charges enter back into the stream here. So that means you are losing your negative ions. So that means efficiency of collection down, and you find as a back corona, and that has to be avoided depending on the type of dust layer.
You
like to stop then?
Yeah, I would say there are a few things which you need to look at in terms of these electrostatic applications. As power engineers, you can see there are two distinct applications which are immediately applicable in a power plant, because right now at least the country is still using thermal power plants based on coal, which is called as anthracite and lignite. These are the two coals which are being used in the country. Okay, lignite is, some people do not agree this coal, but it is a young coal compared to the other one. The other thing is, coal also needs to be used efficiently, so some of the plants try to recover the unburned coal from the ash that's collected, and that's where separators are used. And it is an art in balancing these forces, because you have electrostatic forces essentially used for acceleration. Charging is done. I have called it corona charging as one charge. Basically, it could be two kinds, field charging and diffusion charging. These are the two which most of the times is done to collect particles from fluids such as flue gases. Even in the cement industry it is used. Even some liquid purification can be done using this. In fact, that's what is being applied even in water purification to some extent. Then the next thing is you have contact charging for application for separation. When you go to the separator, you're going to have contact charging. The simplest contact charging is triboelectric effect. While you look at the triboelectric series, which tells you how they are separated from each other, so that F1 and R is different, you are able to charge them oppositely. Otherwise, induction charging when they are conductors. Once you charge, you accelerate. That's why you have two stages, initial stage, and you will observe in a precipitator, the electrode used for charging region is having smaller radius of curvature, while that in the collection region, you have larger radius of curvature, so that there is no field enhancement. You need only acceleration and finally collection. These are the things, and you are aided with the mechanical forces. It's for your creativity and ability. Use gravity wherever possible. If not, centrifugal forces or linear displacement, it could be in any direction. A suitable combination. And if you look at the charging of fluids, we use corona charging. Solids, when you need to separate, you use contact charging. If you want to separate one conductor from another conductor, you use induction charging based thing, and all this is the thing. And one small thing which ma'am said, that you don't use agarbattis in US
and Canada.
No, I'm not saying that. You tend to be cautious because it's all enclosed atmosphere. I just drew a diagram, that's a typical American calendar, candle. What happens is you have a candle in a glass jar with a wick, so you have a cap also which fits tightly. You open it, light the lamp, you do your prayer, and close it. This is available. These are and they come with nice perfume smells of different rose, lavender, and all those things. Now coming to the corona effects on power lines, a power system operator is only worried about power loss to begin with. But then, he has to live with a telephone engineer, so the EMI comes there, telephone or radio engineer, and society that gives you psychological problems, like the audible noise, sometimes you do get headaches.
So I just wanted to add to that incentive thing, like even just because you are in an office room and you want it to smell nice, don't start putting those air fresheners. They are very bad. You are inhaling a lot of bad chemicals. Thinking of
it smells nice. Yeah, we again meet at 3 o'clock. Right now we are going down for a group photograph for the course. So we begin the afternoon session now. To continue where we left, we were looking at the empathetic perspectives. And one of the things which we left with was the possibility of retaining charge depending on the resistivity of the particle that's collected. As a result, the charge buildup on the collection electrode leading to backflash over, which is also termed as back corona, backflash over. You will come across this term again in transmission engineering, where you talk about the, due to lightning activity, tower top, which is supposed to be a ground potential, attains very high potentials. And there is a flashover across the insulator string. Normally, you expect from a high voltage electrode to the ground electrode. In this case, from ground electrode to the high voltage electrode because of the increase in potential. That's why it's called back flashover there. Similarly, back corona here. And one of the main things which happens is the resistivity, size of the particle, and then the image forces come into picture because of the ground electrode. All this contributes to it, and therefore wrapping becomes a very important principle, and the amount of wrapping, number of times, and additional thing that's coming is, don't energize pure DC. Have with some ripple, or have the AC over DC, kind of superpose, pulse superpose over DC, so that there are occasional flashovers that thus gets released. So we'll continue from there.
Just to refresh our mind what we were talking, we already wrapped up that. So we want the useful corona attained wire, but we don't want the corona or any discharge activities to start in the dust bin. If you do that, then you are going to have neutralize all your negative ions with the positive ions, and then the particle charging will not be present. The goal is to charge the particle. This plot here shows us a function of applied voltage, the current measure. So if you had only these negative ions, then it will have a good characteristic. When you start recombining these charges, you can see the current can shoot up at very low potentials. This is for different resistivity of the pole, 10 to the power plus 9 ohm meter, or the left to 2 orders of higher. So higher the resistivity of the dust.
Higher the resistivity of the coal you burn, the flue gas will have particles with higher resistivity, accumulates, gives rise to a big resistive current. Can this picture we saw this? Okay. So now, in theory, it looks easy. A wire is there, you apply a high voltage here, and the plate is here, on another plate here on both sides. But in practice, actual practical industrial scale ESP is much more complex than we can explain on simple theory. The number of electrodes you have, the number of plates you have, adds to the complexity in terms of handling the power, plus the type of gas. That's where the dynamics comes into picture. We have no control on what is the gas that comes in and comes into this. Okay. The gas here, we are telling, yes, multiple parameters to control this. We are burning coal, but then you are burning the coal, what it produces, what type of soot comes, what's the flow rate. You can see the chimneys, what is happening. So we have no control. On top of that, there may be some, as I said, sometimes they don't use just the electrostatic principle. We also merge the chemical part as well. They spray ammonia to help. Okay, for example, in this high resistivity problem, now we can spray some conductive liquid to reduce the resistivity. So that big dynamics here makes energization of these electrostatic precipitators very challenging. So one aspect, high voltage engineering is application you can see using a very high voltage DC power for generating a constant or stable corona. So the better control you have on the stability of the corona you inject, the better control on the charging of the particles. But we have no clue what kind of flue gas it is coming. So that's where the challenge becomes. At the same time, you want to maximize. So this is where the power electronics becomes handy in energizing these type of power supplies. Okay. It's a schematic here using line commutated. That means each incoming line, electrostatic precipitator here. It doesn't sink in this way. So the precipitator here itself is requiring a DC power. All you have is those wires and the plate. So only maybe single phase is okay or three phase is okay to convert the power thing. So let's start with this schematic we have in line commutated. Then you have rectifier here after the high voltage transformer, which converts that into DC. These are potential divider for the measurement. Current measurement here, so that voltage is one to apply to the precipitator. Most often we don't call it as a DC power, we call it as a transformer rectifier output. When you have if you don't do any filter or add any capacitor, it will be like half wave rectifiers going. And you convert full wave rectifier if you have, it will be on both. But if you have a half wave rectifier, then you have rectified here, nothing rectified here. So most industry will go for the full wave rectifier. It has those controllers. Instead of having continuous DC, what can we do here? That's a little bit of understanding. Okay, I have the conversion done, transformer here, and then the inversion part, and then again you have a DC high voltage rectifier. The rectified voltage goes here. So when you are trying to do that rectifier, in the older design, they started controlling here the firing angle, so you don't have to have all of the full wave sent, the average voltage will be lower. Okay? So you can control the SCR, the firing angle for this, the trigger pulses, automatic control. So how it helps, and just look at these numbers here. If you're going for a line commutated using the thyristor control at 50 cycle, it almost needs 10 millisecond, or at 60 cycles, you need 8.6 millihertz. So that produces pretty high ripple as well because your frequency is very low. And then because of this, so if you're only using OR as opposed to that, if you're using completely IGBT controlled bridge circuits like this, then you can operate the inverter here at a much higher frequency. So original designs are used to the line commutated, that means only power frequency. Here you convert everything first into DC from the incoming three phase and then back invert it into high frequency AC, which is fed to this transformer. And there's a big advantage here, what we are trying to do in terms of this practical precipitators. And these operate almost as high as 20 kilohertz. So I'm just going to relate what Dr. Kishore was telling just before we started the lecture. If this is the precipitator you are looking at to maximize the efficiency, I would raise the voltage difference so that highest corona is occurring here. Okay. But we don't know at what point that highest corona will begin. It's under clean air condition, it will be different. But your flue gas contains lot more contaminants. So then already you saw dry insulator flashover was different. We just wetted, it was even different. But if you put a heavy salt water, it had different mechanism. So now when your flue gas content concentration or the composition is not known, we really don't know how far we can push that potential difference here or your supply voltage, so that we have maximized corona here. Right? Or we want to go up. Let's say we went up to 40 kV. We think, oh, good enough. Maybe 41 kV, 42 kV, 43 kV. Right? And then it's going to have a flashover. Right? So what the difference between what we think theoretically and the practical, in practical application, on purpose, they allow certain discharges. Maybe one discharge for every minute. Or maybe one discharge for every 10 minutes. So they calculate this and they allow. That's the only way in an unknown condition you can maximize the efficiency of energization of your ESP. So now, instead of applying 40 kV alone, maybe you are producing sufficient ions, but if you were to go to 45, you can get a much higher drift velocity. You have to remember both things you have to achieve. Not only the voltage maximizing here, you get the corona done well, you also want to increase the voltage difference in potential so that more of the charged particles. So even if you look at here, let's stay with the single phase. So if you're charging, you want to have a highest ions produced here so that you have the more charging done. But when in the point of collecting those particles, you want them to have enough particle accumulate on them and go to the ground or the plate electrode with a maximum efficiency. So that is directly proportional. The drift velocity of this charge carried is directly proportional to the potential difference here. So you want to maximize that difference in potential. But really, there's no clue. It's all had to be done in real time, because the flue gas coming here, also, every minute it may change. Every hour, if not every minute, every hour it may change. So that's why these high voltage power supplies, we control using a power electronics devices, are much, much better handling these type of precipitators in terms of having the controls. Look at here. Now this plot will help you to understand a little bit of this. We are never going to go and apply a stable DC like this. First of all, understand there is a ripple, whether it is IGBT controlled or it is thyristor control, the ripple is there. And remember the fact that intentionally occasional discharge means the breakdown, is allowed. So the corona discharge is a must. Occasionally you want to allow a breakdown here. At the time of breakdown, if you happen to have a breakdown, you're going to lose a lot of charges. So then you want to recover back before the flue gas is passing away, bring the potential back so that you don't let the particles go away. So these have to be the things playing in the role. So this plot has a single phase line commutated thyristor power supply. So what it shows here, the top one is the voltage applied, and then the bottom one is the discharge currents resulting in ideonization. So this part is high. Okay. Let's say we don't know what happened before. So let's say that is the time we energize the ESP. Slowly we are ramping the voltage to its maximum, and then there is ripple here. So they take it there. They leave it at that point, even though they know it may have a flashover. So there's a flashover here. So corresponding to that, there's a flashover here. Okay. So if that flashover happens, I think some numbers are given in the previous one, so about 20 to 100 millisecond duration you need before you start allowing the potential to rise again. So you can't, so that means you need to have a very good control. That's why all this complexity comes here. Very good control in such a way that what you are applying to the electrostatic precipitator is not as just stable DC. You don't go up and stick it here. You go in a stepwise, you reach maximum. That maximum may be 43 kV this hour, and it's working, but they are pushed to the extent that there will be a breakdown in five, maybe a minute later. Again, they have to ramp it up. So that's the whole idea here, how ESPs are energized. Okay. And of course, there is this corona discharge. So if there is any higher magnitude discharge, maybe due to back corona or maybe due to breakdown, then you have a very big deionization process happens. In the sense, loss of all those charges. This is the ionization part. When you are generating only one polarity for the usefulness, if you have a back corona, you're generating again positive ions here, ionization internal. But if you start having recombination here, then it is called deionization. Deionization can also be an electron being neutralized by a positive ion. An electron is used to neutralize a positive ion, it's also deionization. In this case, more often, positive ions will combine and cause the deionization. But if there is a breakdown here, full breakdown, then you produce both positive and negative charges, then you lose all of those useful negative charges because of recombination rate. But this is where the tendency is trying to move towards IGBT, inverter type power supply, and this plot again compares the two. So if you are looking at the voltages here, the dark full line here is the voltage you can achieve with IGBT controlled power supplies, and this line here is the voltage you can achieve with thyristor controlled power supplies. From the previous slide, you already know that supposing if there is a breakdown here, then you have to allow almost about 100 milliseconds before you start ramping the voltage up here. Okay. So you are going up the voltage here, good corona, good corona, good corona, good corona, and they may leave for a certain time at that level, but it may have a flashover, and again they have to come back, wait another 20 to 80 milliseconds before they do this ramping. Okay. Whereas with the IGBTs, you're going to operate them at much, much higher frequency. So every cycle is very short now. Instead of 10 milliseconds for a 50 cycle, you have very, very short duration. So the voltages and current can be, see the way, you, the amount of time you have to leave between the two is much shorter here. And then you ramp up the voltage also in a very short time, and it is left for a long time, and there is a breakdown here, they come back again starting this process.
But DVDT is more
now, using IGBT. DV by DT will be more, yeah. That is also efficiency of raising that potential could be higher. I mean, it's not only more, it is smoother. Because you can go with a multi-layer convert type of converters you can use, it will be much smoother as opposed to a thyristor done at line committed. And corresponding currents in the same condition, this is the current you have with the thyristor control. So when the voltage is only at this level, the current is this magnitude. As you go up on the voltage, the current magnitude also increases. Whereas with IGBT, you have a much smaller current control here. Because there's a continuous current, we don't have a problem about that, but big amplitude, you don't, like every time there is a discharge, you don't have to deal with a big amplitude current. So this is kind of trying to summarize here that today's modern electrostatic precipitator, they tend to use the inverters using IGBTs. And again, within that, there's a lot of work everywhere Power Electronics Group is doing, how to get multi-level ones, smoother control on the voltage, how to increase the repetition rate, how to increase the switching time. So all of those things can be taken into advantage, because this is where the modeling helps. Okay, in terms of the finite element technique model, you can only account for all the changes in the chemical as a charge density. So if you know the charge density, and that's related to the electric field, so if you can solve those equations and see what can be the potential that is best before the corona inception or before the discharge can occur. And of course you have to combine Navier-Stokes equation as well, because you have the flow and the temperature. We didn't talk about any temperature here, sorry about that. These electrostatic precipitators do not operate at room temperature. The flue gas that comes in here is burning the coal. So it's substantially high temperature, hundreds of degrees of Celsius they have to deal with too, depending on at what temperature that particular coal they can burn. And they don't want to burn halfway through, they want to burn fully to get the benefit of the fuel efficiency type. And it's not for the thermal stations, you can use them for also in industry applications too. Just to wrap up on the industry application side, this precipitator, although I said in the introductory slide, precipitators are used not just particulate contamination, but also capture these unwanted gaseous combinations to enter the atmosphere. Okay. So the way it works, if you have particles of all different sizes, smaller the particle, it is even more efficient. The gas molecules, they also kind of reside on the particles. So if you're capturing the particle, along with that, you're also capturing gas molecules. Sometimes inside of the CSP, it's three different discipline working together. Inside of the ESP, if instead of letting NO2 gas into atmosphere and combining with the moisture if there is rain and having acid, they do the chemical changes to occur within the ESP before it starts letting, within the chimney, before it leaves and passes the electrostatic precipitator. So you can actually, for example, if mercury is there, you can use high oxidation to oxidize mercury into oxide of mercury or mercuric oxide. So that's more like a powder. Then the challenge is using the precipitator, how to capture the powder form of mercury. That's a very toxic element to let the mercury come out. But the coal, when you burn, it's not simple carbon. It has zinc, it has cadmium, it has all these heavy metals. Sorry, I didn't have too much time to cover everything, although the slides do indicate in between, you're not only focusing on that, there are heavy metals within that. Percentage maybe 1% or even 0.5%, but their toxicity is more critical. So as a result, we are looking at not just inhaling part of the particle, other chemicals as well. Okay, so that at least, I know it is too much to take in, also too much for me to teach. Just remember that we're not applying a stable DC. It is rectified here, transformer rectifier units. You can control the firing angle, or you can even make the firing angle longer. That means the average voltage can be controlled. So they play with the controlling the firing angle if it is only transformer rectifier units. But if it is IGBT controlled, your frequency at which you can control the switching has more flexibility. Again, you can control when the gate has to be triggered and average voltage and how quickly you can bring the voltage back. So occasional flashovers or occasional breakdown is intentionally allowed, not that it happens accidentally. Intentionally we allow that. But how many to be allowed per minute and how quickly the voltage has to be ramped back without letting more of the particles to escape into atmosphere is the challenge the engineers have to work with, for which they have to have the idea of the flue gas and the time, because it may, again, as I said, when many things are happening in industry, every cubic meter of gas coming may not be exactly the same composition. So that's where the power electronics controlled power supplies are getting more and more popular. So now, I just thought of finding a title for this, retrofitting effect. So originally, we already have a lot of precipitators operating using the TR type of power supplies. Now, in order to replace all of them and put a new modern power supply, it may be more expensive. In those cases, what we can do, so assuming that this is where the DC voltage is applied for this corona part, so you know that corona is there. Every single person trying to understand ESP or trying to model ESP, first thing they do is measure the VI characteristic under the given condition. So it may look so funny, or as if you don't know how to measure current, those like the magnitudes of the current. So when you have the VI characteristic, you know approximately within 10% where to keep the DC voltage. Deliberately, this DC voltage is kept about 5% lower than what they can really apply, which may cause occasional breakdown. So you keep it lower, and then they apply superimposed pulses on top of this to enhance the ionization part. If you constantly leave the DC, then you may end up having the problem with the breakdown. So instead of that, they have a DC voltage applied, occasional fast pulses superimposed onto the DC. So this helps if you already have a TR set supplying an existing electrostatic precipitator, you want to improve the efficiency of charging ultrafine particles, or you want to use the same ESP for capturing oxides of some metals or even NOx and SO2. That's where pulse energization comes into picture. If you look at the schematic here, it has electrostatic precipitator is modeled here in the center, and then you have a power supply on this side that gives you the pedestal minimum DC requirement, And then you have another set of pulse energy here from the DC to the switching, which applies simultaneously on top of this. So there are power supplies, they do isolate this power supply for that DC voltage, and then you don't need a very high magnitude, so you can do this way. So if it is all, if you have a new isolated one, you can apply the superimposed pulses here. Then that source has to be isolated for that 50 kV or whatever minimum. Or you can have both of them applied with respect to the same ground, then you need these pulses, much bigger amplitude, so that you go above this average field. So this also helps, this kind of energization also helps with the back corona, in terms of controlling the ionization part. So that's another idea of utilizing high voltage engineering and power electronics for this application. These are the currents, voltage waveform of a steep front pulse measurement, generator current due to that. And in fact, the Japanese have come up with a technology, Professor Masuda's lab, to generate those high pulses. Either you use spark gap or a rotating spark gap, which is very easy to build, and then you can get a high voltage pulse powers. He showed efficiency of capturing lot of submicron particle using that type of power supply. But today there are electronics control power supplies are used. So once you have a combination of a DC plus this overshoot, a number of times you can apply, and how wide the pulse has to be, you get a lot more flexibility in terms of the control here. And there's some references. I'm just trying to rush through so that we can cover all these three. So in simple, at least, I know it's a mid-afternoon on a Friday. As precipitators are energized with the DC source. And DC doesn't mean that it has to be a stable DC, unipolar is what you count. Lower the ripple is best, because you don't want a high current, so lower the ripple is best. And in practical use, we want to apply the DC to the fullest level, even though we know there may be discharges happening. And that is done to allow certain number of discharges for every period of duration. So you know that you're getting maximum of them at the same time one discharge. If that one discharge happens, how to bring the potential back? Because there isn't one discharge means you have a big current flow now. Neutralizes all your charges, you had to push the charge back. So that's the question, how quickly you can bring the potential up so the corona starts again and the drift velocity, the drift field is established. Otherwise, particle will escape, right? So that's all. And again, remember that measuring the efficiency of particle collection, if you go by weight, you probably are fooled, because for the smaller size particles, they may form large in numbers in terms of volume, but the weight very small. Okay. So if you let even 1 gram of particulate contamination into atmosphere, if they are in submicron level, you probably will be letting millions of them per second. Okay. So some of the newer measurements they even go for, they get a full chart of collected particles, what size and how many distribution. They also do those online continuous. That itself is a like how the SEM, the TEM, the instrumentation has developed. In particle count, they also do that. So there's some good references here. I generally like this paper by Professor Gross. He's done good work about application of different high voltage supplies for industry applications.